Hello everybody. Welcome to this very special episode of Talking Pictures that we've put together to celebrate the 150th birthday of our beloved locomotive Josephine. The story of Josephine is not just the chronicle of a machine, it's also about people. And I thought we might use this episode to focus on some of the characters who helped bring Josephine to life. On the 25th of January 1870, the Otago Provincial Government entered into a contract with engineer David Proudfoot and coach proprietor John Thomas Chaplin to build the railway. David Proudfoot had earlier been responsible for the construction of the Ross Creek Waterworks, which opened in 1867, and in 1879 he would establish Dunedin's tram network. His brother George, a railway contractor, worked with him on a number of projects and was manager of works on the construction of the Dunedin to Port Chalmers Railway. In 1877, George was charged with sexual assault. The jury in the subsequent trial couldn't reach a verdict, so a retrial was ordered, but again the jury couldn't decide. The brothers moved to Australia during the economic downturn in the 1880s. When a flood destroyed a railway line that he was building, David became bankrupt. He died while undergoing surgery in Sydney in 1891. Hoppy Chaplin was well known as an owner of the Cobb & Co. line of coaches in the late 1860s and early 1870s. His role as a partner in the construction of the railway didn't last long. Financial difficulties caught up with him, and a few months after the railway contract was signed, he was replaced. His half share of the contract was taken up by hardware store owners and iron merchants Oliver and Ulf. Richard Oliver would become a well-known public figure. In 1878 he was elected as a member of the House of Representatives, winning the seat vacated by William Larnock. Oliver settled back in England in 1899 and died there in December 1910. But back to the story of building the railway. Work began on the 29th of August 1870, when subcontractor Samuel Packham and his gang of about 25 men began forming an embankment between St Andrew Street and the foot of the Stuart Street jetty. None of the promoters or officials were present, so Samuel Packham took a moment to hold an unofficial ceremony, smashing a bottle of wine over the first barrow load of earth as it was being tipped. Three cheers were given, Packham treated his workers, and then work resumed. 2 weeks later, there was another temporary halt in proceedings as the men went on strike, seeking a pay increase. They were paid 6 shillings per day, wanted 8, but settled for 7. British railway engineer Robert Fairley, who was known for his patented double-ended locomotives, was chosen to supply the plant required for the railway. The rolling stock ordered from England included 2 of Fairley's double locomotives. These were built at the Vulcan Foundry at Newton Le Willows in Lancashire, while carriages and wagons were constructed at the Bristol Railway Carriage and Wagon Works. In 1871, Richard Oliver went on a trip to Britain and checked out how things were coming along. Getting there was an epic adventure for Oliver. At Melbourne, he and his wife boarded the ship Queen of the Thames, which set off for Cape Town, where it would refuel. But when the Queen of the Thames was rounding the southern tip of Africa, about 180 kilometres short of Cape Town, passengers and crew were woken up as the ship struck heavily again and again. Donning their cork life jackets, the passengers assembled on the upper decks and waited for daybreak. When dawn finally arrived, evacuation of the stranded ship could begin. All but 4 made it safely ashore. Richard Oliver paid the captain for the immediate recovery of his luggage. As a result, he managed to get all his belongings back, while most of the other passengers who waited for the subsequent salvage of the vessel, found some of their possessions stolen in the process. Then it was off to Cape Town to find a new ride. Passage was obtained on the Britain, a vessel Richard Oliver would describe as the slowest of the slow. It was an uncomfortable journey. Makeshift quarters had to be prepared for the late additions to the passenger manifest. Stewards slept in the passages. Portholes couldn't be opened as the vessel was so low in the water. And Oliver recalled that the rats and bugs were a caution, and many slept on the dining tables rather than face such bloodthirsty enemies. On the 10th of May 1871, a couple of weeks later than originally anticipated, the Olivers finally arrived at Southampton. They would spend the rest of the year and the beginning of the next in England, so Richard Oliver had plenty of time to catch up on where things were at with the supply of the rolling stock. It was the beginning of a period of industrial unrest in Britain, with workers striking in search of a maximum 9-hour working day, perhaps not an ideal time to be having railway locomotives and wagons built there. While he was away, Oliver's business partner back in Dunedin fell ill with a fever, and on the 5th of November 1871, Thomas Burt Ulf passed away, aged just 37. A couple of weeks later, Richard suffered a second blow when his father, 80-year-old Robert Oliver, passed away in his hometown of Penzance. One important achievement by Richard Oliver during his time in Britain was naming the two locomotives, Josephine and Rose. That's all we have time for in this episode. Tune in again next time for Happy Birthday Josephine Part 2. See you then, and thanks for watching.